they're hot here, looking a little hairy because you had a rough day of school already, but I'm going to make a little video about your test that we're having, even though I know we're going to go over in class, I thought I would make this just in case you still had questions and didn't have enough time to ask or whatnot, so here we go. Be nice. Maybe I'll put a word somewhere in there, you can have extra credit that shows you that you actually watched this whole thing here. Wouldn't that be exciting? Who knows? We'll see what happens here. First of all, I have to be present on the screen so we can talk about this. I probably think we'll get to too many jokes here, but here we go. Let's see what we got going on here. I got to move all this stuff here. In case you need a review about all this stuff here, here we go at Hyper Warp Speed. You should have already asked most of these questions here. So, problem number one, what is the better buy? 3 pounds of potatoes for this or 5 pounds of that? In order to do problem number one, we have to do what we in math call is find. We need to find what we call the unit price. We need to figure out how much each one costs per ounce so we have something to compare with. We've got 3 pounds for potatoes for $2.85. Now, remember I said cost per pound. Cost per is the fraction on the pound. So money is going to go on top because that's going to cost $2.85. And how many pounds is that? 3. If I divide this out, I'm going to get how much it costs for 1 pound. So 2.85 divided by 3 is 0.9. 7. So the first one, this first one is 95 cents per pound. Second one, I have to do the same thing, $4.65 divided by 5, cost per pound. If I do that out, 4.5 divided by 5, get 9. This, the 5 pounds, is only 93 cents. So which one is the better buy? The 5 pounder. 5 pounder is the better buy cheaper per pound. Mary wants to buy a bike for $290. She already has $110. The job pays $15 per hour. How many hours do you have to work during the rest of the month? Well, let's see. If she already has $110, that means she will pay $110. For the bike that she has right now, subtract the $110 she already has. That means she only has to come up with $180. If she makes $15 per hour, you just have to see how many 15s it's going to take you to get 180. So that's your division problem. 180 divided by 15. Here's to me, B. You're going to have to work for 12 hours today. 12 hours, you pay for that for all these bikes I have right there. Oh, origin on here. The spinner is spun twice. Make a tree diagram to show all possible outcomes. What is the probability of spinning a tree both times? I guess by tree diagram, we should do that. Here's the deal. It's spun twice. On your first spin, you can either spin a 1, a 2, or a 3. But the reason this is called a tree diagram is because we're going to make something that looks like a tree. That was my first spin. I still have to spin a second spin. If I spin a second spin off of each one of these, if I spin a 1 first, on my second spin, I could spin a 1, or a 2, or a 3. On my second spin, I could also spin after a 1, a 2, or a 3. And on my third spin, I could also after spin a 1, or a 2, or a 3. Now, if I were putting all those together, ladies and gentlemen, this would help give me a sample space because I would just have to put it all my combinations. Here, I could spin a 1. I could spin a 1, I don't know how to make this, I could spin a 1 and a 1, a 1 and a 2, a 1 and with three. Or, a second, if you're less than a two-thirds, I could say two and one, two and two, two. Or, I could spin a three-thirds, get three and a one, a three and two. This is my sample space, and this is my tree diagram right here. Question is, what's the probability? Maybe you're gonna show possible outcomes, what's probability of spinning two both times? Well, I have nine total combinations there. Correct. And if there is only one time, I'm gonna spin through two both times. Probability that it's just one time. But this is so much fun. Describe the shape of a graph that represents the following situation. This ball is going up in the air, then falls to the ground. The graph relates to the time. To the ball distance from the earth.
So it basically says this. Here's your graph. Unfortunately, it doesn't say if it's going up in the air or out in the air, but it's going to look like this. Here's my little person throwing the ball. Here he's going to throw it up in the air for a long time. He's going to keep going up, and that's going to come back. I won't get too worried about that, but that pretty much looks like the graph of a ball that's going up in the air. You might say, well, if you throw it straight up in here, but all those can't throw balls completely straight up in here. We'd like to throw it a little bit more like this. But either way, you get that. Or I will let you throw that. Good point, Mr. Hahn.
By the way, if you keep this silent, ladies and gentlemen, here is the special word that I will give you extra credit for. If on your test, for problem number five, in addition to writing the answer, you also write, hip hip hooray. If you also write, hip hip hooray, spell like that and hyphenated, I will give you a plus five extra credit points because you actually watched this video at this point. Who knows? Maybe I'll put another one in there. This was kind of fun. Problem number five. Simplifying problem number five. The only problem with problem number five, ladies and gentlemen, is right here. It is this negative exponent. We do not like negative exponents, so we need just to make that exponent positive. And the way that you make negative exponent positive is by if you're on the bottom of the fraction, go from sending them to the top, but if you're on the top, you have to be absent from the bottom. So I end up with my x to the third on the bottom and my y to the third on the bottom. But ladies and gentlemen, if you take something from the top, you need to keep something on the top. Those are still on the bottom of the fraction. There you need a 1 up there. It's not the same case with the bottom. If I move the number to the top and I only have top number, that's fine. I can do that. Because anything overloads itself. But in this case, if you're moving everything to the bottom, you have to keep that one at the top. That is the one. Oh dear, look at problem number six. It's a whole bunch of positive and negative decimals. You have to work from left to right. There's another option. I start with a negative 5.76, ladies and gentlemen. To that, two negatives put together here means I actually add, it's actually a positive 1.61. Here's the deal, if I have a negative number and a positive number and I'm putting them together, I have to subtract them. If you want. Okay, forget that this is a negative. Let me just write down 5.76. I need to find the difference between these numbers because they have opposite signs. So I'm going to subtract 1.61, 5.76, and see what I get. I end up getting this 4.15. But since my negative number was bigger, that means my answer negative. I have more negative than positive. To that, now I have to add 0.97, which is the same thing. They're opposite signs. So in reality, to figure out what my balance is, I have to subtract those two things. I'll subtract them. I get 2.48, but the same thing holds true for this. Right, this one was negative when I started, and this one was positive. That means this number has to be negative. If I add then here, ladies and gentlemen, to this negative 3.18, I'm adding more negatives. If I add two things that have the same sign together, I actually have to add that together. I'm combining those, and my answer can be negative because I add two things that have the same sign together. I keep the same sign and add them together. Or, I did all this way, use my focus with me. If I get negative 7.44, there's a good chance, by the way, boys, you know that I did something wrong or something. Changing colors, here we go. Problem number 7. This is quiz buying square tiles. Oh, by the way, I'm saying this must be an area problem because we're talking about squares. The floor measures 10 feet by 15 feet. Oh, that means I should probably draw a floor that is 10 feet by 15 feet. 15 feet by 10 feet. Each side of a tile is 2.5 inches. Oh my goodness, if this is Quinn buys 3,450 tiles, are there enough tiles to cover the floor? Holy smokes, this is actually a problem, by the way. Okay, well, here's the deal, children. Here's the deal. I don't know if there's an easy way about this or there's a hard way. Basically, we need to find the area of this, but one of the first problems we have to deal with is our tiles are in inches and the dimensions is in feet. So I would say to fix that problem, we either have to change this to feet or that to inches. And changing this into feet just gives you some, either you got to work with fractions or decimals or something. So I don't think that would be the sense that are really decimals. Let's make these. The first step I would do, and you probably want to write this down in your notes. The first thing you want to do is make these inches. So unfortunately, this one's easy because 10 feet is 10 feet. This is 120 inches. And this one, 15, actually is the same thing as 10 violations. 15 times 12, 30, 15, 100. So my first step is I have to figure out how many total square inches I need. So unfortunately, two ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take 180 times 120 to the hand. That is going down to zero. Let's just do this so I can see where it is. Then I'm going to start the second row with zero. I need 21,600 square inches. So is that my answer? It is not. The question is, we need to figure out how many of these goofy little squares that are this big it's going to take to do this much more. Let's make this out a little bit. So 21,600 square inches. Each square, each one of these little tiles is 2.5 by 2.5 inches. By the way, sometimes it's easier to do than the fraction, by the way. What is 2.5 and 2.5? What is 2 and 1/2 times 2 and 1/2? Well, I do that by way of 5/2 times 5/2, and that is 25/4. Each tile, ladies and gentlemen, covers 6 1/4, or 6.25 square inches. Which means, kids, this is getting crazy.
Which means that you can definitely.
I need to figure out how many tiles I need. There's actually two ways you could do this, man. You could, let's do this. If I have 3,450 tiles and I multiply by 6.25, covered that much, will that be a number bigger than this 21,600 or a number less than that? Or I could simply take 21,600 and divide it by 6.25 and see if that number is bigger or smaller than this. I think not getting 21,600 divided by 6.25. Say that. Here for this. So here you go. So I'm gonna guess that 6.25 is gonna go for this 3 times. That's 6, 7. Or this is gonna be putting in the lab. I might make this problem extra credit. Let's see, if I subtract here, this is a 5, is a 10, where the suspense gets almost killing me, because if this number becomes bigger than 4, I know that I need more tiles, and that won't be enough. But this is a 4 we have to be gone. Let's put 4 in there just to see what happens. 4 times 1 times. Oh boy, now we gotta keep going because I got this 350. 50. And then now I'm at 0. How many times do you suppose 625 is gonna go up to 330,500? And again, my number up here is a 5. So let me put 5 up to that. And then 525. 12, 31. Ooh, look it. We're still in good shape, kid. Oh, 4, 10, 9, 5, 7, 6, 7, 5, and then I bring down my last 0. Now, here's the deal, ladies and gentlemen. I know that I'm going to get some number over here. I know that number can't be 0 because that would mean that you're going to come down here. So that means I am going to need more than 3,450 tiles. So in answer to all that, when all the smoke clears, I have just 45 minutes on a problem like this. The answer is no. Really should look up this in the book. Problem number 8, boys and girls. If you are looking in your notes under properties of mathematics, okay, hopefully you can see this. First of all, you do see parentheses. And parentheses usually make you think about the associative property. But in the associative properties, the numbers have to stay in the same order. And in this case, they are not. Starts with a 4, this one starts with an 11. So really all that's happened is in multiplication. These two numbers have flip-flopped or moved from one place to another. So this is the commutative property of multiplication. Problem number 9, write 6 times x in words 2 different ways. I guess you could just say 6 times x or 6 multiplied by x or the product of 6 and x. That is something to be held on that. Graphing the equation y equals negative x using the table, decide whether the graph represents a function or whether it is linear or not linear. That's exciting. That's not going on here. The field of thought says to make a table. I got my x and y values, so I just pick anything for x
Out of the blue, let's pick a 3 or a 0, and let's say it ended at 2. Find y, I just take the opposite of x, because that's what a negative x would do. So if I give it 3, that's a 0. I'm going to say that is positive 1. I put a 2 in. So when I graph this, building, I get 3, negative 3, 0, 0, and then negative 2, positive 2. Graph looks like this. And looking at all the rules here, they're asking us, is it a function? That would be yes, because of the vertical line test we talked about before. Vertical line test means I draw straight up and down lines, so I never cross those lines more than one. So yes, to a function. And ladies and gentlemen, linear or nonlinear, if it forms a straight line, it is a linear function. That is. So we've got three graph. It is a function because of the vertical line test, and it is linear because it is a straight line. So far, so good. Here we go. Let's hope the second half of this test is a little more exciting. Problem number 11, the first truck in the convoy will carry 12 tons of dirt with each additional truck will carry 8 tons of dirt, right? Rule them out of the situation, then you can find the rule of how many tons of dirt can be carried by 7 trucks, that n represents the number of trucks, and t represents the number of tons of dirt.
Oh, boy.
Now I can see how this can be confusing, because you know what, if I count the words, it's going to be crazy, but like I told you, anytime they ask you to write an equation, anytime they tell you to write an equation about a whole bunch of gobbledygook words, do this. Figure it out. Pick a number. Let's say I have just 3 trucks. And I want to know how much dirt they can carry. Well, the first truck will carry 12 tons. So I know I get 12 with the first truck, which means I only have 2 trucks left. Okay, and those additional trucks carry 8 feet. So I have to take 2 times 8. I have 2 of those 8. When I add those together, I get 16. 12 plus 16 times 8. So what equation could I use for that, where m is the number of trucks? And T is the ton of dirt. So what is the rule going to be? What did I do? Okay. Well, the first truck is always going to be the first truck. I'm always going to have 12 because that doesn't change ever. So my first rule is I'm going to take, I'm going to start with 12 tons. I start with 12. Do that, I need to figure out a way. With n being the number of trucks, I need to multiply by 8. Remember, I multiply by 8. What number am I multiplying by 8? Well, here I multiply by 2, but if I had more trucks, I multiply by a bigger number. How did I figure out that this number was a 2? Well, I took the number I started out with and subtracted 1 because that first truck carried 12. So that is what I multiply by 8 by. I take the number of trucks, subtract 1 from it, because the first truck always has 12 and I don't count that ever again. So there is my beginning. Okay. And then my answer is how many tons I will move. So this, ladies and gentlemen, would be the answer to a problem. Now, if I enter it for the use to find out, then use this to find out how much 7 trucks could be. So you just put 7 in for 100. 12 plus 7 minus 1 times 8 equals 8. 7 minus 1 is 6. 6 times 8 is 48. So 12 plus 48, you end up with 60 tons of dirt. We want both this for the rule and this for the answer. Wow.
crazy. This one's an easy one, graph the order here, -2, 3, 3, make sure you know this is your X, that's how far over you go first, so I go over -2, 1, and I go up. Finding X and Y intercepts for problem number 13, ladies and gentlemen, we also talked about this before, remember to find the X intercept, you cover up the Y term, have that go away, and you say, 2 times what number is 18? If it's a division problem, you can do it like 2 times. To find the y, it's about 14, right? So that might be fine. To find the y intercept, you cover up the x. You get the y equals 18, so 2 times what number is 18? It doesn't tell you to graph it, it just says find those intercepts. Problem number 14 is the way of 9, so this is the easy one for you. 8.45 times 2.7. 2 decimal places there. There's 2 decimal places there. 12.5. Hope I did that right. Forgive me if I didn't make a mistake here. Problem 15, ladies and gentlemen. Again, we talked about this so many times. Go ahead. If you have a fraction in front of a letter, 3, 4, x = 6. How do I get rid of fractions in front of letters in the equation? I flip and multiply. I multiply by 4/3. X equals 8. It's probably time for a little more on the cutting here, don't you think? So for problem number 16, by the way, if everybody in 8th grade puts all these extra credits down, I know that you guys are told people to do this. Everybody tells everybody, I'm not going to count, but I'm going to show you that actually watch it do it. I often try to do this question. Well, problem number 16. Write down the word on your test. K-boom. Make sure you put K! That'll help you know you'll get another 5 points extra credit. Remember the extra credit word is A-boom. A-boom. Alright, so here we go. Problem here, solving some equations here. Remember when you do equations, the first thing you do is you try to simplify the side before you mess around. You can't do anything with 3b-8. But on the other side here, I can combine 7b and minus 4b. They're like terms, they have the same letters. If I have 7 of them and I take 4 of them away, I'm left with 3b. And then, ladies and gentlemen, here's where things get dicey. Second step is you need to move all your letters to one side and your numbers to the other, which gives you this, children. I subtract 3b here, and I subtract 3b here. I have an oh no moment because I end up with 0b, so that is not good. Talked about this before, okay? You have to, though. You can't stop here because you've got to figure out if your other side of your equal sign ends up being a 0 or if it actually is a number over here. So to do this, I have to add 8 to something. If I add 8 here, I get 6. Now, here is the deal. In order to solve this for me, I have to divide 6 by 0. I have to do this, and I can never do that. Okay. You can never ever do that. That's against the first command of the band. You just can't do it. This is unsolvable. There is no, I repeat, absolutely no solution to this. No solution. Can't do it. That would be the answer. For problem number 17, we have to do the distributive property first. Simple time. Okay, 4 times 2 and get 12a. 4 times 2 and get 8. And all equals 50. still not done simplifying because I can combine these like term two formulas. If I have two A's and add 12 more A's to it, I have 14 A's plus A equals 50. What do I have to get rid of now? I get my numbers to one side. Spreadsheet with just three more problems to do to the nearest integer, the square root of 77. Well, what we have to do is we have to do more multiplications for this because we want to figure out what perfect squares is the square root of 77 fall between. So let's think about a number smaller than 77. We have to use two numbers to have numbers. 7 times 7 is 49, and then 8 is 64, and then 10. The square root of 64 is 8, and the square root of 81 is 9. My choices are, it says in the nearest integer, which one do you suppose 77 is closer to? 1, 4. Now this is 13 away from 64 and 4 away from 81. Here's integer. My estimation. Here we go. Evaluate p, parentheses 3 p. So I know the first thing we want to do is look at the right problem. This is for all of my lectures. 15, there's my big parenthesis. 3 times p minus 2 times q, and I guess q equals 2, minus p times q. And I'm going to put that in my numbers. Oh, good, everything gave us fractions. So this is 1 half, 2 times. Which is again 1 half minus 2 times q, which is 1 fourth minus 1 half times 1 fourth. Let's go on to something. Go back to this. So we've got three different parts of this problem, which you might think is strictly the problem here, people, but because you can simplify this parenthesis, you are going to want to do that first. What is 3 and 1 half? Sorry, 3 half, you have to multiply. I get 3 halves for this. And subtracting 3 and 1 fourth is 2 fourths or 1 half. So that whole parenthesis, when I was multiplying, is 3 halves minus 1 half is going to give you, oh look, 2 halves. Is the same as 1. Now I have 1 half times 1 minus whatever we two multiply together, which is 1 half. So look at x answer. 1 half times 1 is 1 half. I take 1 half, subtract 1 eighth from it. This is 4 eighths from this 1 eighth. So I take 2 eighths. And finishing up solving for n, this is a great problem to finish up on. Super good problem. The direction say to solve for n. Well, the first thing you have to do before you solve for anything is simplify the whole equation because you can combine and move stuff and change stuff around. You can add some other terms here. In other words, this. I can subtract this m and move it over here and subtract it. I suppose I will. I could subtract
my 4M over here, subtract it from the 2M here, which would be negative. And I still have 8 of my minus 6 over here. So that off, everything moves on the right, so I'm left with a negative 0. The directions told me to solve for this beautiful letter M here, so I want to get everything that doesn't have an M to the other side, so I'm going to add 2M. That's M, 2M. So I'm going to add 6. I add 6 over here. I know that equals 2M. I want M by itself, so I am going to divide everything by 2. And that means I end up with an M, plus 6 divided by 2 is 3. So leaving them on the letter M equals M plus 3. That, ladies and gentlemen, is how we in the math world do this. Crazy test. I hope you enjoyed that as much as I did. My day is about over. I can only take so much more. Really, I appreciate you watching this. And again, if you watched it, you got that extra credit stuff. Pop it in on my test and we'll give you a little extra credit. Just because you took the time, spent the time, and watched this crazy long video. Thanks, 8th grade.